Let's begin with a prayer. Let's worship. God, our provider, we are your church today, and we need you in so many different ways. Some of us need strength because we're facing a big challenge. Some of us need hope because we feel like giving up. And some of us need love because we are feeling alone. But Lord, we trust that you will provide for us, whether through words or music or in moments of reflection. We know you are here with us. So as we come to sing worship, I'm going to read some words from Jeremiah 10. All this is nothing compared to you, O God. You're wondrously great, famously great. Who can fail to be impressed by you, King of the nations? It's your very nature to be worshipped. Look far and wide among the elite of the nations. The best that they can come up with is nothing compared to you. It is God whose power made the earth, whose wisdom gave shape to the world. It is he who crafted the cosmos. So with those words in mind, let's praise this God that is in control of everything, that made this world. Let's stand and sing Praise is Rising.
See you. Now, I'm on the all-age message slot for today. So, this is going really well, because there's obviously lots of children here today. And Alan changed all his plans as well for this morning, so my all-age message led really nicely into what I was going to do with the children in the back room as well. But we're not doing that today anyway. We'd already changed our plans on that. But I'm going to go ahead anyway, because, you know, we all learn from a little all-age message. We're all ages, aren't we? So my first question to you all is, what do you want to be? Or maybe I should rephrase to, what did you want to be when you grew up? Can you remember when you were little boys and girls, what you wanted to be when you grew up? Oh, Bob. A mechanic.
Never happened.
Never happened, right, you know. Sue?
A waitress.
A waitress.
My mother was not impressed.
Oh, anyone else remember? Sandra?
I wanted to be a thespian.
Did you?
Yeah.
A thespian. David?
I thought being a coal man was a
good coal man. Oh, my word. Well, we're going to have a little clip, I've got to go with Pete's, because he still thinks that this is going to happen one day, and every day I'd have to tell him it's not going to happen.
I have two, actually.
Oh, you're not allowed two, that's greedy.
I wanted to be Elvis. Oh. I also wanted to be captain of the England cricket team.
Yeah.
Outside chance, I think.
Some of you will know this little creature, but in case you don't, we're going to have a little song from a little chap called Simba. Does anyone know Simba? So Simba is the lion cub in the Lion King story. And this is one of the fabulous songs in that film, show, whatever. And Simba was the lion cub, the son of, now I'm not going to say this right, Mustafa, who was the king of the lions. So Sarah, because she's awesome.
I'm gonna be a mighty king, so enemies beware.
Well, I've never seen a king of beasts with quite so little hair.
I'm gonna be the mane of it, like no king was before. I'm brushing up, I'm looking down, I'm working on my
roar. The spar, rather an inspiring thing.
Oh, I just can't wait to be king.
You've run a long way to go, young master, if you think.
No one's saying do
well, that'll be, we'll go there, sir. We can all play it at home later. So Simba was one of those that just wanted to be king. Now, top quality props again for those of you here a few weeks ago. It's all right, there's no Peters in this week. I'm just looking at Peter there because I had three Peters in the room and I only thought I had two last time.
But this week I've got a Jesus. Anyone like to be Jesus? So I'm going to just go to these guys at the back. They don't get a choice. You can be Jesus.
And then I was hoping that in my little question earlier that somebody would have wanted to be a pilot. Did anybody want to grow up to be a pilot? Pete, you'll have to pretend, because I can just volunteer you.
Yeah, sure.
There you go.
Pilot of the England cricket team.
Pilot of the England cricket team. Wow, maybe. So I was linking, wasn't I, all about Jesus, really. We'll start with Jesus. We'll talk about pilot in a minute. But Jesus could have grown up to be a lot of things, couldn't he? I wonder what he did think he'd like to be when he grew up, because he could have followed in his father's footsteps. Top quality props, I tell you, top quality props. And he could have been.
I've got a sore thumb, actually.
He could have been a carpenter, couldn't he? Or he could have been. No, let's put them down. Next one. Oh, hang on, I've got a bit tangled in my bag. Oh, a bit very tangled. You'll like this one. He could have been, and, because it's top quality props, he could have been a fisherman, couldn't he? Oh, here's one he could have been. Oh, can he catch? What about this one? He was quite good at healing. So he could have been a doctor, do you think? Okay. This one, Ian. Can you turn this water into wine? So here's your water. See, I think, potentially, could have been a winemaker. So you've got to get this right, Ian. Could he be? You can put your first aid kit down.
Turn wine into water.
Can you turn the water into wine? So I think you pour the water into your jug, see if it, and then see if you can turn it into wine for me.
I'm not sure this is going to work.
Why? We haven't practiced this, have we? So,
I'm not sure it's going to turn into wine.
Well, let's see what happens. I've got a steady. Oh, look at that! Look at that! Woo! And the kids aren't here to see it. Oh, I hope they're all watching on YouTube, because look at that top quality props.
That looks lovely. Yeah, I'm going to try that at home.
Yeah, you can take that home. We're not allowed alcohol on the premises, so no, we're not over here. Okay, so he could have been a healer, but actually he was born to be. I'm not sure how big your head is, but he was born to be king. So. Alan's little series, you see, was leading up to Easter. So today's little talk about a character was about Pilate. So I thought we'd have, we've got Jesus and we've got Pilate here. And then, oh, I have my notes. So in this bit, I've got a little bit of a, I'm going to see what they say to each other. So Pilate starts, and Pilate, what? Yeah. Oh, I'm doing my talks. No.
Oh, that's it then.
I did maths, not English.
I don't think it's that kind of pilot. I don't think he's flying a plane. Is that you've got his Top Gun glasses, but I don't think, I think you've spelt it wrong.
Oh. Oh. I've gone a bit wrong. Do you want to? Sorry, Sandra.
Well, you want me to correct it?
Well, you're the teacher, not me. Oh, I got this story wrong. It's a good job Alan's not here, isn't it?
Yeah.
Got my story wrong today. Well, I didn't know who would want to grow up to be Pilate, so I guessed it was a pilot.
Not a pilot. A pilot.
Not a pirate either.
Not a pirate.
Pilot.
Is that right?
Oh, it's a good job you're here, Sandra. It's a good job Sandra's here. So Pilate says, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus says, "Is that your idea? Or did other people talk to you about me?" And Pilate said, "Your own people handed you over to me. What have you done?" And Jesus said, "I am not of this world. If I were, my servants would defend me. My kingdom is in another place." And Pilate said, "So you are a king?" And Jesus said, "Yes, I am a king. I was born and came into this world." But Jesus was born to be king, but not an earthly king that wears a crown and rules over the earth. His kingdom is in heaven, where he rules now and forever. Ooh. Well done, both of you. Thank you. Thank you, Sandra, for correcting my spelling mistakes. So I've also got a fantastic action song for the kids today. So you're all going to love me after today, aren't you? Because here I am with no children. And I've even got children's activities, so if you get at all, you know, bored with our service this morning and feel you'd like to go and do a little bit of craft activity at a table, please feel free. But I'm going to sing The King of the Jungle anyway. So if you don't know the actions, well, you'll work them out as we go along, because we're up here, crown on our heads, monkeys for the jungle, a big circle for the universe, and blah 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 like that for the sea. So we'll have at least two choruses, I think, because then I can have my aerobics for the day. Go, Tom, all over to you. I'm going to switch my microphone off so you don't want to listen to me sing. Shall we all pray together? Our Heavenly Father, we come to you in prayer this morning with praise on our lips and worship in our hearts. And we come to you today, your day, and thank you for this beautiful world you created, for the sunshine
and the rain, for the spring flowers and signs of new life. But we also see this beautiful world tarnished by sin. And our thoughts in recent weeks have been very much concentrated on the situation in Ukraine and the terrible suffering of the people and the destruction of their land, their homes, hospitals, and civic buildings. But there are other areas of this world that are suffering too, including Afghanistan, Syria, and Yemen. We pray for those who grieve, those who are injured, those who are trapped and afraid, and for those who are defending their country, and also for those who have become refugees. And we thank you, Lord, for all who have been helping the refugees in various ways, and we do pray for the efforts to find a peaceful solution. We pray for our people of our town, the local council, the schools and colleges, the hospital and local health services, the shops and businesses. And we pray for all those who live and work here. We pray for the churches in Western and Worle, and we pray for the activities and services. And we pray that many will be blessed from hearing your word. And we ask for your blessing on the Alpha course and for the opening of the Renew Cafe in April. We pray for each other, for those of us gathering here, and for all those listening at home. May we all be blessed and united in the loving name of Jesus. We pray especially for those in our congregation and our family and friends who have COVID. May they know your presence as they recover from this illness. Lord, you know all about us, our worries and our stresses, concerns about our loved ones, and fears for the future. Help us to cling to your word. In the book of Philippians, we read, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen."
Thank you, Pam. I think we're going to have this is the part of the service where we're going to do our covenant renewal together as a fellowship. And Alan has pre-recorded this so that he's able to lead us through this part of the service. So I'm going to go over to Alan, I think.
Let us then say these words together. I surrender to you, Jesus, my Saviour and Lord. Knowing your great love for me, I dedicate again all that I am and have to you. Fill me with your Spirit, that I may become like Jesus more and more. I dedicate myself in love to the people of this church. I affirm its vision and values, recognizing that God calls us to live in unity and holiness. I will encourage others in their discipleship and welcome their encouragement in mine.
beauty for brokenness, hope for despair. Lord, in your suffering world, this is our prayer. Pray for the children, justice, joy, peace. Sunrise to sunset, your kingdom in.
Bible comes from Genesis chapter 15, verse 1. The heading in the Bible I have is God's covenant with Abraham. After this, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abraham. I am your shield and your very great reward. But Abraham said, O sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless and the one who inherits my estate is Eliezer of Damascus? And Abram said, you have given me no children, so a servant in my household will be my heir. Then the word of the Lord came to him. This man will not be your heir, but a son coming from your own body will be your heir. He took him outside and said, look up at the heavens and count the stars, if indeed you can count them. Then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. Abraham believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. He also said to him, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to take possession of it. But Abram said, O sovereign Lord, how can I know that I shall gain possession of it? So the Lord said to him, bring me a heifer, a goat, and a ram, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a young pigeon. Abram brought all these to him, cut them in two, and arranged the halves opposite each other. The birds, however, he did not cut in half. Then birds of prey came down on the carcasses, but Abram drove them away. As the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep, and a thick and dreadful darkness came over him. Then the Lord said to him, know for certain that your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and they will be enslaved and ill-treated 400 years. But I will punish the nation they serve as slaves, and afterwards they will come out with great possession. You, however, will go to your fathers in peace and be buried at a good old age. In the fourth generation, your descendants will come back here, for the sin of the Amorites has not yet reached its full measure. When the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoken brazier with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram.
There's something solemn about a covenant. It's more than just a contract between parties. It's a solemn undertaking, guaranteed by oath and with obligations that are binding. And it's an important Bible word. In fact, our Bibles are divided into two by covenants. After all, testament is just another word for covenant. So we've got the New Covenant, the Old Covenant, New Testament, Old Testament. Covenant is a word used some 285 times in the Old Testament. And sometimes it's between human parties, but more importantly, it's used in the context of God's relationship with his people. The book of Deuteronomy, for example. Deuteronomy is the fifth book of the Old Testament, the last book of Moses. It's got covenant written all over it. With the 40 years of the wilderness wanderings about to come to its close, and Moses' own death imminent before Joshua would lead them into the promised land, Moses led the nation in a covenant renewal service. It was a big open-air affair. And the whole book is Israel's covenant document with Yahweh, its Lord. And characteristic of such covenant documents is a list of the responsibilities of those who are committed to the covenant, along with its blessings for those who keep it and the curses that are invoked for those who break it. You can see the list of those curses and blessings in Deuteronomy chapters 27 and 28. But there was and is a serious problem. For you see, while God could be counted on to keep his obligations under the terms of the covenant, human beings, being sinners, would fall hopelessly short and so incur the curse of God for their rebellions and their faithlessness. But the good news is, centuries before, God had foreseen that and had got it covered. So, let us go to Genesis chapter 15. And in the first bit of chapter 15 and verse 18, we read, on that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram. Now, it all started with a vision in which God spoke to Abram, confirming his previous promise to him. Verse 1. After this, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your very great reward. But Abram is bothered. he has seen no sign of God's words to him coming true. And he expresses that in verses 2 and 3. Abraham said, "Sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless? And the one who will inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus." And Abram said, "You have given me no children, so a servant in my household will be my heir." Then in verses 4 and 5, the Lord further reassures Abram. And Abram, to his credit, believed God. Verses 4 and 6, let me read them. "Then the word of the Lord came to him, 'This man will not be your heir, but a son who is your own flesh and blood will be your heir.' He took him outside and said, 'Look up at the sky and count the stars, if indeed you can count them.' Then he said to him, 'So shall your offspring be.' Abram believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness." And that's a key verse that Paul picks up on in Galatians and in the letter to the Romans. And in order to further reassure Abraham, God takes him through a personal covenant ceremony. Now, what people did in Abraham's day was not make a covenant, they cut a covenant. The Hebrew word translated made is actually cut. And it reflects the fact that when a covenant was cut between two parties, an animal would be sacrificed and cut in two. The covenant parties would then walk between the cut body of the slain animal or animals, symbolically saying that may what happened to these animals also happen to us if either dared to break the terms of the covenant. A more serious form of what we used to say is children, in fact. I don't know if it was true in your day, but in the school playground, you'd hear people say, "Oh, cross my heart and hope to die," in terms of making a solemn promise. Anyway, God instructs Abram to kill and cut a number of animals. Verses 9 to 10. "So the Lord said to him, 'Bring me an heifer, a goat and a ram, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a young pigeon.' Abram brought all these to him, cut them in two, and arranged the halves opposite each other. The birds, however, he did not cut in half." So here we have the scene set for the two parties for the covenant, God and Abram, to cut their covenant. What happened? Verse 12. "As the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep, and a thick and dreadful darkness came over him." God then reaffirmed his covenant promises to Abram, and then God symbolically walked between the cut animals, invoking its curse should he fail to keep his word. Verses 17 to 18. "When the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking firepot with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. On that day, the Lord made or cut a covenant with Abram." But didn't I say that both parties would walk between the carcasses? Well, yes. But here, it is only God. Which meant that God would be the one on whom the curse of the covenant would fall if it was broken, even if it was Abraham or his descendants who actually broke its terms and conditions. I'm going to fast forward now, fast forward the biblical story until we come to the cross of Jesus. I want to look at Matthew 27, 45 to 46, and also Luke 23 and verses 44 and 45. "From noon until 3 in the afternoon, darkness came over all the land. And at about 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, 'Eli, Eli, lima sabachthani,' which means, 'My God, why have you forsaken me?' And then in Luke 23, verse 44, 45, "It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon, for the sun stopped shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two." On the cross, in Jesus, the curse of the covenant made with Abraham was taken onto himself by God. The covenant was broken. Abram and his descendants made a right mess of it. But God carried the can, so that Paul, writing to the church in Rome, could exclaim, "Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." And so we, humbly and I hope joyfully, will celebrate as we take the communion, where the bread is broken and the wine poured out. Today, we have renewed our covenant obligations to God and to one another. By this time next week, we will need to confess our failures. But just as God had got the failure of the people of Israel, Abram's descendants, to live up to their covenant obligations covered, so God has already got our failures covered with the body and the blood of Jesus, broken, poured out, so that our sins, our failure to keep the terms and conditions of the covenant, can be forgiven. And for that, I am very, very thankful and glad. So let us take the bread and the cup in this service of covenant renewal, and from our hearts give thanks to God for his amazing grace, which meets us and greets us time and time and time again. God bless.
For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes."
You're invited to come to this table, not because you must, but because you may. Not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Come, not because any goodness of your own gives you a right to come, but because you need mercy and help. Come because you love the Lord a little and would like to love him more. Come because he loved you and gave himself for you. Come and meet the risen Christ, for we are his body. Loving Father, we praise and thank you for your love shown to us in Jesus Christ. We thank you for his life and ministry, announcing the good news of your kingdom and demonstrating its power by lifting up the downtrodden, healing the sick, and loving the loveless. We thank you for his sacrificial death upon the cross, for the redemption of the world, and for raising him to life again as a foretaste of the glory we shall all share. We give you thanks for this bread and wine, symbols of our world and signs of your transforming love. Send your Holy Spirit, we pray, that we may be renewed into the likeness of Jesus Christ, and formed into his body. We pray in his name and for his sake. Amen. Jesus said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in memory of me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper and said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed by my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this in memory of me." Blood of Christ shed for you. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise. that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Lord, keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. We're going to stand to sing our final song today, which is Sandra's choice. It's a wonderful song, though. Oh, happy day. Fantastic. So we end on that amazing note of praise. We've
made promises together, Lord. We promise to follow you, and we know that the promises that you make to us never fail, Lord. And with joy, we think about that day that is to come, that we know that we have every hope in you because we have a promise for the future, Lord. So as we go out this week, Father, we trust in you. We trust that you will be with us, that you will be holding our hand, that whether we are sad, whether we have pain, that you are there beside us, that you are there to comfort us. Lord, help us to go out trusting and knowing this, not just in our minds, but in our hearts too, Father. And shall we say the grace together? May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.